Hi there. We are already at the end of week 6. To help you remember integration, we will summarize the essentials. At the start of week 6, we wanted to determine the total energy consumption of a house during a certain time interval. However, we only knew the function Pt, describing the power function as a function of time. In order to determine the total energy consumption, we divide the entire interval into smaller intervals and pick a sample in each interval. We can then approximate the total energy by summing the delta T times the power at each sample point. The approximation sum is called a Riemann sum. If we take the size of the intervals to 0, then in the limit we obtain the exact energy consumption. The value of this limit is called the Riemann integral. Remember that an integral always has a geometric meaning. It is the signed area of the region between the graph of the function and the integration interval on the horizontal axis. By signed, we mean that the area of the parts below the axis should be subtracted. However, with this definition, we can only approximate the actual integral because it is very hard to evaluate the limit in general. Lucky for us, we can use the fundamental theorem of calculus. This theorem tells us that if we have a continuous function f on the interval from a to b, and we know that small f is a derivative function of capital F, then the integral from a to b of small f equals capital F in b minus capital F in a. This function, capital F, is called a primitive function of f. Don't forget that when you find a primitive function capital F plus any constant is also a primitive function of small f. Of course, choosing a different primitive function does not change the value of the integral. Because of this connection between differentiation and integration, we can use our list of standard derivatives to obtain some of the standard integrals. We will now walk through the rules of calculation again. Our first set of rules is about the interval of the integral. The integral of any function from a to a is always equal to 0. We can also split an interval. The integral of a function f from a to c equals the integral from a to b plus the integral from b to c. And the last rule, the integral of f from a to b minus equals minus the integral of f from b to a. Our second set of rules is about the function itself. The integral of f plus the integral of g equals the integral of f plus g. The integral of a constant c times f equals c times the integral of f. None of these rules tell us how to calculate an integral of products or compositions of functions. In fact, there are no general rules for these cases, in contrast to differentiation. We did derive some helpful rules in case we are integrating the composition of a function with a linear function. We found that the integral of f of x plus c from a to b equals the integral of f of x from a plus c to b plus c. This corresponds to a shift of the graph of the function to the right or to the left. The integral of f of c times x from a to b equals the integral of 1 over c times f of x from c times a to c times b. In more general cases, when faced with an integral of a combination of functions, you can try the substitution and rewrite the integral to a simpler one. Let me recall the steps in an example. We start with a complicated integral, like the one shown on the side, on the slide. Then, we try to re-express everything in terms of a new variable, u, related to x by the equality. This is called substitution. For example, we can choose the substitution u equals x cubed plus 5x. From this relation, it follows that du equals 3 x squared plus 5 dx. Now we can express the integral entirely in terms of u and du. The new integral is easy to evaluate. Finally, we turn to the original variable and we have found the answer. In case of an integral with boundaries, we can also apply this procedure. Just make sure to also express the boundaries in terms of the new variable. Another integration technique that we have seen is integration by parts. You can use it to find an antiderivative of a product of functions. It works as follows. Suppose we want to integrate the product of functions f and g. Suppose that capital F is a primitive function for small f, then the integral is equal to capital F times g minus the integral from capital F times the derivative of g. Like the method of substitution, this technique does not give you an antiderivative directly. Rather, you can convert the problem of evaluating a given integral to evaluating another integral. The goal is then to ensure that the new integral is easier to evaluate than the old one. That's all there is to integration for now. This was, of course, a quick summary, so if you didn't entirely understand the part, you should go back to the video explaining that part. Good luck with the exercises!